Thank you, Carlota, for the introduction. It's my pleasure to be here. So this is the second time I will give this talk, and Carlota chose this talk, although it's a new one. I'm not an AI person, but I use machine learning every day. So this is more like a philosophical talk, and you will see why. And it has to do with this issue of black boxes that people are using, and they don't understand what they do. So we'll try to give you some insights on that. So how many people here consider themselves an AI person? OK, so sorry for these seven people, maybe not technical enough, but I'm sure they will be philosophical enough. So I think I will skip the first slide, because the first time I gave this, this presentation to general public in the Big Data Congress last month in Barcelona. But then I will basically go deeper and deeper in the problem of explainable AI. And then I will talk also about responsible AI and the future. And that will be more philosophical. So I will skip this, but you know about machine learning, you know about big data, that now we have much more computing power. And now we finally we can use neural networks, which is something very old. But now they call it deep learning. So just as before, new names for all things, so they get trendy. But before starting talking about explainable AI, I want to talk about complexity and size. And this was inspired by a recent talk in the IEEE Data Science Conference in Italy by Claudia Perlich. And it's just to, so you think about complexity, what it means complexity when we're using a lot of data. So for example, I can take a few pictures from Carlota from the web. That's small data, particularly because you cannot find many more. So these are like six that I took four. So it's small data. And I can train a deep learning model to basically label two things, Carlota or not Carlota. This is not a so difficult problem. But the only thing we did a translation of representation from images to text. The system doesn't know how complex is Carlota. Yeah? Much more complex than just a label, right? Like any of you. So this is small data, not too so complex problem. Now we can take a formula like the famous Einstein formula. Energy is like the mass times the speed of light squared. And this is big data. Why? Well, the formula is simple after Einstein gives that formula to us. But that applies to any mass in the world. So basically, for any object in the world, the same law will apply. So here is big data because you can apply it to all objects. But the complexity after the formula is found, is the model is very easy, like a linear model, right? But now we can take the stock market. The stock market is very complex. Otherwise, it would not exist, right? If all people could predict it, it would be a mess. It's small data, big data. Doesn't matter how much data you use, because it's a very complex problem. So try to predict it. It's trying to predict like 1 million people, what they will vote. Not very easy. And then we can go to like an open domain. I hope you know this famous picture, the Garden of the Lights. One of my favorites. And imagine that your task is to label every image, every piece of the image, every object in the image. And of course, you know this picture, the images is like strange images for animals, so it's not the standard animal, so it will be very hard to label if you use a standard training collection. So this is a more complex problem, and then you will need big data to train that. Okay? So this is the scope of things that we need to explain. So what is explainable AI? And this DARPA program started 2 years ago. And I'm taking slides from their program, so I don't need to redefine what is that. So this, I will use the DARPA definition. So these are the questions that you need to answer. Like, why the system did that? Huh? Why didn't do something else? Why it succeeded? Why it failed? Do we have enough confidence in the decision? I will get back to this. How can we correct an error? And of course, here you have the classical examples of that you see in the news, like Watson, AlphaGo, or for example, DeepMind program that played chess with itself and became the best player of chess in the history of humankind. So yeah, I think any of us, if we play like 40,000 games, we can be really good if we have some aptitude to chess. So these are the questions, and this is the problem. So what are the goals? So today, we have training data. We have some machine learning process and model. You learn a function, you learn a model. And then you have a task where you take a decision. And basically, you cannot answer these questions. So we want to change this process to this new one that will produce an explainable model. And then we'll have an explanation interface that will tell the person why these things. I understand why, I understand why not. I know when you succeed. I know when you fail. I know when to trust you. And I know when you made a mistake. It looks very simple, like in this picture, but it's much harder than that. And you will see why. So these are the goals of this program. And this DARPA program is funding many research groups in the US. So the next question we need to ask is why we need this. And there are many reasons why we need this. So the first one is verification of the systems, what now is called algorithmic transparency. And that is important for us, but also for society. The second reason is to improve the system. So for example, are the objectives clear? If we have more than objective in the system, what are the trade-offs? Some systems are very sensitive. And recently, there was a very interesting paper. They took three classical deep learning approaches to image labeling. And they showed that just by just changing one pixel, they could change the label. So for example, this horse becomes a frog, right? This dog becomes a cat, which is, OK, not so bad. It's a pet, at least. Yeah. But this deer becomes a dog. Ah, the bird, another frog. So frogs are very easy to, I guess, to label. And this sheep becomes an airplane. Yeah. And they even use dropout. If you know dropout, is basically you take part in every part of the backpropagation process, you take out some of the nodes of the neural network, and you train with part of the neural network, and you repeat the process. That's to give more robustness and not basically overfit or learn things that are like by chance. Still, you can do this one pixel attack. And surely there are people working on how to resolve this. But this shows how sensitive are deep learning models to what they are trying to learn. One thing is that maybe they are learning things that we will never guess, in the sense that they are learning, like, for example, maybe here the frog is one that has always this pixel in black, and that's why it appears. Although here it's not true because the pixel is white. But these things may be true. Like you may learn some silly things like this example I will show later about wolves and dogs. So the next reason is that you want to learn from the system. For example, you want to learn causality. You want to understand what is happening. And this is also very important. However, there are other reasons that are non-technical. So the first one is compliance to legislation, for example, for safety, for privacy issues. And I will get back to this. I don't know if you know, but this is the new data privacy law of the European Union that impacts this very heavily. And I will get back to that. And then finally, ethical issues. Again, transparency. Let's say you go to a bank and they say, no, you can't have the loan. Why? Oh, the system said so, right? I have heard this. And can you explain me the system? No, it's too complicated. I'm not a computer scientist, so I don't know about the system, but I trust the system. Or they order us to trust the system. And then for fairness, for example, gender or race bias. That will be a completely different topic, which is also one that I love. But that's very important, like for us. And it's just one example of how you can learn not to be fair. And I'm not taking data from the US, which would be the classical example. This data is from the UK. So this is real data from the criminal justice system in the UK. And you see this is the percentage of different races in the population. Here you have white, black, Asian, mixed, Chinese, and others. And here, typically, this means Indian. And then you see the population, the arrest, the prosecution, the convictions, and people that go to prison. So of course, if you learn from this data, for example, people from, let's say, African American origin will have a higher chance than what should be to go to jail. Well, but sometimes this may help us too. So you can read the joke. So maybe the answer, the car will answer, yes, we know. They give us the ticket. Yeah. So maybe in the future we will not even need police. I don't know. So the next question is, do we always need explainable AI? And the answer, of course, is no. It will be like very, very complicated if every machine learning model has to explain. This is what in the European Union is called automatic decision making. And it's not only for machine learning, for anything. So basically, if you use a system that takes a decision automatically, you will have to read the GDPR article about that, and I will get back to that. So the question is, when can you do an automatic decision without basically explaining it? And there are two cases. So one case is that there are no real consequences for unacceptable results. So basically, no one is harmed. There's no damage to anything. So why not? I mean, we can make a mistake, but nothing happens. Or the other case is that the problem is so well known and validated that we trust the system decision. And for other constraints, we need to trust the system decision. So example of the first case is web advertising. So yeah, sometimes we get ads that we don't like, but I hope nothing gets more than offended. No one commits suicide because of an irrelevant or offending ad. Or for example, postal code sorting. Yeah, maybe sometimes a letter gets to a wrong place, but they will return it, so nothing happens. An example of the second kind of systems is like today, aircraft collision avoidance systems. They have to work in real time. They cannot be tired. So a lot of lives will depend on that. And you know, this system is better than people, like traffic controllers in airports get tired. And also they do mistakes. So we need to trust this system and take some automatic decisions like, okay, this plane has to be diverted in this direction because otherwise we'll have an accident. So the challenge, and these are only three examples, is which systems can or should be fully automated. There's no answer for this question. Of course, we want to have as many as possible here, but you know, the line between people think that is acceptable or unacceptable is a line that moves with every individual. So it's very hard to get a consensus like in many other societal controversies. Now, going back to the problem. So what is the framework that people want to construct? And this comes again from the DARPA program. So I already mentioned this explainable model and explanation interface. And then the user makes a decision based on the explanation. So in this case, this is not automatic decision making. There is a person there that is in control. And I want to say a person there that is in control. I will get back to that, but I don't like this, saying this like it's a human in the loop. Why? Because we are in control. We are not in the loop. We should be in control. And if you think there is only one human here, no, there's a lot of humans doing this too, right? Everything came from humans. So humans are in control, even if we don't want it. We did the model, we did the explanation, and a person will take maybe the responsibility of that decision, but we are in control. So what happens when this person is not there, when we take automatic decision? Well, one thing will be, this will be the case of automatic decision making, and this will be, remember, I think I want you to remember, that this is not only a recommendation, decision, or action. Remember that these are only predictions. The system may make a mistake. We may have some score, like with 80% trust, you should take this decision. But this person may say, okay, 80% is not enough because I will affect the life of a person. So I will say no. But then, these are predictions. These are not like final answers. And something very important is that if you have automatic decision making, you need to have contestability. So you need to have a process, legal, to say, and this has happened in the US, there were a couple of cases, for example, with using machine learning in justice, where they went to court and they showed that the answer of the system was illegal. For example, it was a famous case in Georgia where a person basically was not given conditional parole because the person was poor. And of course, that's not constitutional. So we need to have this contestability process that is not well written today. Now, contestability could be much larger. We could have contestability while we build the model. Maybe you want to have a group of experts that looks at which assumptions you are taking, because usually the computer scientists are not the experts in the problem. Maybe you want to have contestability while validation and training by a different set of experts, like statisticians. Let's see if you did well the validation and training. So contestability is not only in the legal point of view, but it's in the whole process. We need to check this process in some way. So we'll get back to that. So there are many challenges. Challenges on the data analytics side, challenges in the automatic side. So for here will be the typical example of the DARPA will be interested in, like using this for war operations. And so there are ethical issues there and so on. What will be a good explanation? And this is an example also from the DARPA program. So let's say you have a deep learning system that tells you that this is a cat. This is the current explanation. But maybe we want something more complicated, like it has fur, whiskers, and claws, and has this feature, these pointy ears that cats have. So this could be a good explanation. Not sure. So what is that? So anyone can use their own neural network and say, what is that? It's a cat, right? We can recognize it's a cat. I mean, we are smarter than neural networks, I hope. Yeah, it's a cat, but doesn't have pointy ears. Yeah. And you know, people that have cats take this kind of crazy picture. This is from the cat is in a class table, and someone took a picture from below. And you can find even more crazy pictures of cats, and you still recognize there are cats. So one thing that you see, and I don't know why, is that systems are afraid to say, I don't know. So how many machine learning classification problems you have a class that is, I don't know? Now, we have a class. I mean, humans should have a class to say, I don't know. Some people don't like to say, I don't know, but most of the time, we don't know. But I don't know why they prefer to give a score. 20% is a cat. But 20% a cat is like saying, I don't know, right? So this is something like you think. I mean, next time, maybe you need to have a I don't know, and then we'll be. So for example, if it's not a cat, if it's a cat, why they have it the pointing ears? But also, interpretability does not imply completeness, and I will get back to that. So we may know that this is a cat, but maybe for other cases, we will not know that this is a cat, because it's too hard. Like, if we get only a little piece of the cat, it will be very hard to distinguish this from other animals. So maybe we have to say we don't know. And you know, the explanations may come not only from the data, the model, the process, from many other places in the system. It's not trivial to explain something. So there are many ways to approach the problem. Here I'm taking a picture from a recent paper by Doran et al. Like, you start with the black box. You can go two ways. You can make it comprehensible. So it's still a black box, but you say things like halogen lights, concrete floor, boxes, machines, and then, okay, yeah. If you have that, probably it's true, it's a factory. Or you can have an interpretable function, and you give the function, so the person can interpret her or himself to basically deduce that it's a factory. Of course, doing this is hard, because if you have a really neural network, you don't want to give the equation, the full equation of the neural network with the backpropagation and so on. Maybe we have to include reasoning, and this is another from the same paper. So you use a knowledge base, and then you do something much longer where you say already that the image has all these features, but for example, you say these objects are often present in and related to factory operations. So we believe, we think that this is a factory scene. So kind of explanation, but it's saying that maybe we're wrong. Maybe it's not true. So how do you tackle the problem? So let's see some solutions to this explanation problem. And here is a nice, another nice slide from the DARPA program, where you see different techniques like deep learning is very high performance, but very hard to explain. So here you have explainability versus accuracy of the prediction. And for example, SVMs are simple. Of course, decision trees are the simplest to explain because you see the question, so you can explain. Well, if you have a random forest with 200 trees, it's a long explanation, but still maybe it's an explanation. So how do you generate explanations? Well, there are two trends, two ways to solve the problem. One, they're model specific. So basically you take a given model and you try to explain that kind of model. And of course, deep learning is the one that all people are looking at because these are the worst black boxes we have. And the other solution is that you don't care about the model and you study the black box and try to basically, by studying the black box, come up with your own explanation, like a, more like a physical experiment. So let me give you two examples of those. Now, the idea is that when you do a model-specific approach, you basically, and here, sorry, because of the images are not always uniform, explainability is on this axis instead of this axis. So here, you may improve or change the accuracy. For example, if you make a model explainable, maybe you will reduce the accuracy of the model because of this need for the explanation. Or if you make, in the case of model agnostic, well, you make it more explainable because you don't care about the model, and then you do some explanation. So this is a good case, I think, in general, but you will see that it's hard to get the explanation. Okay, so let me give you one example for deep learning. This was a survey from Samek et al. Last year. And here they show two different ways to get this explanation for deep learning. And these are the two cases. For example, in one case is using something they call layer-wise relevant propagation. And in that, the other case is sensitivity analysis. So these are two ways that you can solve the problem. And of course, just explaining these two ways to do it will be like another talk. So you just go and you can read the papers. But these are two ways to explain neural networks. What about a model agnostic approach? This is much more simple, and then I can be explain it in one slide. So the idea is to study the black box using local perturbations. So for example, you can study this model. Let's say this is a real model. So this, let's say this is a yes, and this is no, whatever, this is a binary classifier. And then study the input, you finally get this line. So you basically find part of the model, and you build an explanation from this part of the model. So in some sense, you explain part of the results, not all of them, because the model is much more complex. And if you can try to basically mimic the model, you will basically need to perturb the whole space of the problem. Yeah. And then these are the real examples of using this technique. It's called LIME. For example, this is the original image. And then this is explanation for electric guitar. So the explanation is part of the image. And you can see, yeah, this is part of electric guitar. This is explanation for acoustic guitar. And this is maybe wrong because it's not electric guitar. And this is explanation of the dog. And you see, at least they get the face. Now, sometimes the explanation doesn't work. And this is an example. There was a famous example of this distinguishing between wolves and dogs. And basically, the system learned that for wolves, there is always a snow in the back. So they didn't learn anything about the animal. But so here, you see the explanation is mainly a snow. So it's not the right explanation. But maybe it was the explanation of the system. There's another famous example where they distinguish cancer images with non-cancer, and they were surprised, 100%. Well, the system learned that the day that these images were uploaded was different. So nothing to do with the image. These things happen, and people don't look at the data, and they find out too late. And then we have the problem of evaluation. This is another recent paper. So you can have a functionally grounded evaluation. You can do that automatically. You can have a human-grounded evaluation with simple tasks, real humans. And then you have application-grounded evaluation when you have real tasks. And the main thing is that each time you are more specific, and of course each time will cost you more, because this could be any person. This could be, has to be experts. Let's say it's a medical system. So in the IEEE Data Science Conference I attended recently in Torino last month, there was a very nice paper about explaining explanation. And I will get back to this. So explanations is about interpretability and completeness. And we'll get back to the legal side. So I will skip for now GDPR. We'll get back to this. But why we need completeness? Well, because we need to explain the wrong thing. And we may be making decisions for the wrong reasons. So these are MIT authors, did kind of a taxonomy of different things you could do. For example, if you use visual cues, you are interpretable but not complete. If you say what are the roles of individual parts of the images, then you are complete but you are not interpretable. And then maybe it's attention-based, you have some explanations. This is interpretable but it's not complete. So it's not easy to have both things at the same time. So why these three things? Well, in the first one, you want to explain the processing. In the second, you want to explain the representation. And in the third, you want to explain the producing of the explanation. So the first is the completeness to the model. The second is completeness to other tasks. And the third will be, for example, for this human evaluation, in this case, will be for the middle level of the evaluation. Will be, okay, simple task, is this correct or not? Is this image correct or not? Is the explanation correct or not? And here is the human evaluation. So here is a taxonomy and best practices that they have in this paper. I don't think I have time to give too much detail, but basically here are the different methods, the processing, the representation, the explanation, and then how you can do the evaluation. And of course, here, for example, in the representation is the place to detect biases, to detect fairness. And here, too, with the human evaluation, you're able to detect biases. And then you can go to responsible AI. And here's one proposal by Kaushik about optimizing, retaining, maintaining, and comply. But then I will use this, the right to explanation, to jump to this GDPR problem. So GDPR, in addition to all these privacy regulations, has one article, the Article 22, which is about automated individual decision making, including profiling. Profiling is building user models of your behavior in the system. And this is the textual article. So it's a legal term. So I will not read it. For example, you need to know what is the data controller. Something very important at the end, to contest the decision. So the person has the right to contest the decision. But this is very lawyer-oriented. So let's say what this really means. So when you need to worry about this Article 22? So you need to make sure that you gives individuals information about the processing. I'm sure in May this year, you received many mails saying, with this email, you accept our new data handle processing conditions, or otherwise you need to opt out or opt in, whatever. I received like 50 mails about this, and I had to, most of them, I deleted them. Okay, whatever they do, I think I'm not private anyway. So if you're using machine learning, that means that you at least need interpretability. So that means that the person can interpret the result later. So technically, you cannot use deep learning right now. Or the second thing that is important is introduce simple ways to request human intervention or challenge the decision. So basically, this is the contest part. So if you're using machine learning, you may need to explain. And remember, automatic decision making is for anything, not only machine learning. It could be a rule-based system, could be like stupid algorithm, and so on. And then you need to carry out regular checks to make sure that your system are working as intended. So this is like a continuous maintenance of the system. Every time you do a change, you need to verify that you are still interpretable and that you have an explanation. And this comes to a different topic, but I think it's related and I want to touch. Let's say now we are using data for these machine learning systems. Well, we can have, in practice, we have a long tail of data. So let's say data is on the y-axis and companies are on the x-axis. So big data is here. But the truth is that most companies in the world will never have big data, right? I mean, every store in a corner, especially in Europe, will never have big data. They don't have enough users to have big data. So why this obsession for big data when most companies need techniques for small data? I'll leave you, all the machine learning people here, I'll leave you that thought. And why this is important? Because small data, I think, is the real hard problem. Most of the time, big data is solved by using more data. And if you're lucky, when you double the data and your training is linear, you're fine. If it's not non-linear, you're in trouble. But then you can buy more GPUs and solve it. You have a scalability issue, but doubling the data will improve your system. And I will not read this, but these are all the reasons, my reasons, why the small data is important. Even there's a book on a small data, if you want to read it. No? Not sure if the book is small for book standard, but so one important thing, small data is easier to explain. So if you want to have automatic decision making with small data, that's much more easy to explain. Remember, your data is also small data. So this is very important. Most data that people consume is small data. For example, all the data that your mobile phone gathers about you in one day, that's small data. It's not big data. And that can be used for personalized medicine, for many other things. I have written this in KD Nuggets if you want to read about it. So this is a table, my own table for the difference between small data and big data. I will not read everything, but here we have part of the famous Vs. There's one missing, which is not important, but here you have volume, velocity, variety, and value, why it's different. And then there are other things that are important, like privacy, density, identity, relations, and flexibility. And you see the differences between these two things. You can find this in the KD Nuggets article too. And why small data is not easy? Let me give you an example from my own work on data for good. So with one of my former PhD students and now with a new PhD student, we're trying to predict dyslexia by playing games. So basically, a person plays a game, like it does some test, and then you say, okay, you may need to go to an expert because you may have dyslexia. Well, the first problem, like in many other machine learning problems, is that the data is unbalanced. Less than 10% of the people have it. And this is called the hidden problem, because sometimes people go to adult without knowing that they have that problem. Like Steve Jobs had this problem. I mean, he was lucky. Most people fail school. So so my former student went to Carnegie Mellon in a postdoc and basically did a machine learning predictor for dyslexia. And these are the real things. Very hard to get people to play this game and also find people with dyslexia to play this game. All these are children. And here there are two results for Spanish and English, the number of children that play the game, and the accuracy of the result. Anything strange for the machine learning people? Yeah, so why?
Unbalanced.
No, this is like well done. So doesn't matter if well balanced. Yeah. We are using the right weighting scheme. So. No, the reason is knowing the problem. Spanish is a phonetic language, so it's easier for people with dyslexia. English is not. I mean, if I never see how to write finite, I will have not a clue how to say infinite, although it's the same root, right? So it's much easier to predict people that speak English because they do more mistakes on the text, for example. Part of the game is about mistakes. And here, for example, also it's interesting where you set the system, because the cost of false negatives, basically not predicting that you have dyslexia, is much higher for society than the cost of false positives, sending a person to see a doctor. Yeah, it has a cost, but maybe the person will be happy. Oh, I don't have dyslexia, right? So at least it's nothing that's hard. But not finding a person that has dyslexia basically is telling that person that will have a hard time doing school. And now we're doing that the same before they learn how to read and write. So the test now is about music and images. And we have right now we have 70% accuracy, which is not that bad, considering that we're not using any letters at all. Okay, so let's go to the next problem, is legal and ethical issues. We already talked about GDPR, but what things we have to worry here? Well, maybe, and there's already many ethical codes that appear in the last 1-2 years, maybe we need ethical codes for developers, companies, and robots. I'm sure you all know the three laws of Isaac Asimov about robots and the nice stories when two laws conflict with each other. Can we have an international consensus? And we get back to this about globalization. I'm sure you have read everything about self-driving cars, so we'll not say anything. But one problem, there are too many factors involved. So how we define ethical algorithms? How we prove explanations? Because even if we have an explanation, maybe a lie, maybe fake news. It's not a real explanation. It's a plausible explanation, but it's not the real explanation. I mean, it's very hard to believe an explanation coming from a neural network, because I know how complex the neural network, so it's not easy to get to the right explanation. I'm sure the explanation is not complete, that's for sure. 1.5 years ago, the ACM US Policy Committee published a small statement on the 7 conditions that algorithms should fulfill. And these are the things. Awareness, so it has to be conscious of the problems that it may produce. Second is about accessing and redressing the data. Third is about accountability. Fourth is about explanation. Fifth is about data provenance, like organic food. You need to know from where the data point came and what happened all the way to where the model uses that and how the system changed that data. Auditability, for example, Cathy O'Neill, if you read the Weapons of Mass Destruction, has an auditing company in New York, and some companies started using that. And the seventh is validation and testing. So the algorithms do not have to be perfect. So bad things will happen. They just need to be better than humans. And for example, in the self-driving cars example, I'm sure that self-driving cars will have many less accidents than people. Now, how many people here know one algorithm that fulfills the 7 conditions? Okay, one condition. That's okay. I think you're right. None. No algorithm fulfills these 7 conditions. And we'll get back to this. Because if we do this, this could be very complex and also may change our profession. Especially with not only GDPR, but also you have seen the new copyright directive, where, for example, some systems will use automatic decisions, for example, to censorship content. And already this is happening in Twitter and other things. And people say, every time I talk about this, they delete my tweet. But it was OK. I mean, there was no issue there. But I don't know, these systems are not perfect. And there are many other similar initiatives. So IEEE Computer Society also is working on this. And there are many NGOs working on this, and so on. So what things we need to fix? And for example, learn from the past without remembering the context. This is a problem today. Learning about human bias, not checking for overfitting and other problems. Reuse embeddings from one problem in another problem. All people is using this in NLP processing. Most of the time works, but maybe sometimes doesn't work. If you go to a company like Palantir or others, and you try to see their system, they will say, no way. I mean, this is a secret, trade secret. It's our life. Inappropriate relationships between the human decision maker to the system. Maybe it was the person that built the system, so shouldn't make the decision. Failing to measure the impact of the deployed system, so lack of accountability and injustice, I think that's part of the problem. Injustice, two words, not one. Individual personalization instead of personas. I believe we don't need to go to the individual level. For most cases, it's not about the person, it's about the task. So you need to basically contextualize the personalization. So it's about what you are trying to do. It's not about who you are. Most of the time you are doing something new and there's no data about that. And here we have a trade-off with privacy, and I think personas are much better because we keep this privacy stronger. And then many times we have inaccurate data or data that just we don't have. And then we can get to, and this is based on something that Jania Matthews wrote and share with me, it will appear soon. Well, sometimes mistakes are not bad. You can read the joke. This was like a viral a few weeks ago. In this case, it's good that the system learned from past data without understanding the context, and humans survived, right? But there are some problems that are very hard to learn, and here, it's not, I don't think it's about bad human practices. It's basically that we are thinking that deep learning can do more than can do. And just I will mention two things that I think are very hard. One, humans, to learn, need to abstract. And to abstract, you need to forget. For example, when you see dogs in many different positions, or a cat from below, you learn to abstract something that you know is a cat. So it doesn't care in what orientation the animal is, you find it's a cat. But for that, you need to forget. You need to take something away. It's not about learning, it's about forgetting. And today, systems are not forgetting. And I like to mention this wonderful short story. If you haven't read it, it's called Funes de Memorius from Borges. And basically, this was a person that couldn't forget. So if you met this person and said, how was your morning? He would take 3 hours to tell you everything about his morning because he couldn't abstract anything. He had to tell exactly. And of course, he couldn't recognize a dog depending on the position. He knew there was an animal, but maybe it was a different position, didn't know his dog. So it's interesting. If we cannot forget, we cannot learn. Like this. To recognize this image, we need to forget. We forget about the ears, we forget other things, but we recognize it. Can you explain it? No, right? Very hard. It's a neural network too, but a different one. And the second, very important, you cannot learn what is not in the data. And this is the case where we need the I don't know. Because all systems fail when you get an example that doesn't resemble to a previous example. This is not the same, but it's something like this. You can read the joke. So this is about forgetting and missing data. Yeah? Remember, doesn't matter how good is your training collection, there's always cases that will not be in your data, right? It's infinity on the other side. So which are recommendations that I think are important for us? And I'm finishing now. So first, designing for people, right? Second, deep respect for the limitations. I mean, deep learning is amazing, but it's not everything. So that means, what are the right assumptions? What are the ethical risks, and so on? For example, the famous paper about detecting gay people shouldn't be published. I mean, that's unethical. But some people think that they like to have their things in their CV. Learning from the past doesn't mean to reproduce it, right? So we don't, unless we are in the case that they have a war and we want to win with the robots. We have to enforce code of ethics. Today, I don't think they are enforced, and we don't use them too much. Improve explainability. So this is about what I talked. More evaluation, and also more evaluation from other disciplines, because the experts, in most cases, are not in computer science. Research best practices with humans in control and machines in the loop. OK? Don't use human in the loop, please. I have seen talks about that. Here I'm borrowing from Harari, and I will talk about him in the next slide. So study more intelligence and consciousness, not only AI. We need to understand more. And it's good that we have a lot of neuroscience. I think that's very important. And if we are going to a world where robots will do a lot of things, then we need to upgrade some jobs that were very important, like teaching. Teachers should be the best paid people, like in Finland. Or children care. Before going to school, these people that take care of children because of other reasons will basically shape the future human beings. So last two slides, the future. This is my real concern. It's a joke here, but it's not a joke. Yeah. This is really what I'm worried about. And I will not mention any country, but I can mention Brazil, for example. So this could be a problem, because maybe we have this. So Boromir Harari, he says, the real problem with robots is not their AI intelligence, but the natural stupidity and cruelty of their human masters. Right? That's usually in history. And then this may happen, not because of robots, because of us. OK? It's a joke, but I don't know. In the future, will not be a joke. So is the future dark? And how many people here have read the last book, The 21 Lessons for the 21st Century? None. OK. I recommend it. I may disagree with Harari in some things, but his writing is so clear that it's very hard to find a mistake. So what he says is that the infotech plus the biotech will dominate the next decades of history. Not in the future, now. And that free will is an illusion. And it's interesting because yesterday in the plane, I saw for the first time this movie, Identical Strangers. Anyone have seen it? No? This is a documentary of this experiment that they did in New York in the 60s and 70s, splitting twins or triplets, and then to see if the parenting was the important part, or basically if the genetic was the important part. And one of the triplets commits suicide, which is is free will, I mean, or not. And it's interesting because one person says, maybe free will is an illusion. We just are determined to do something. I don't know, but Harari says the same. And he says something that really worries me: humans can be hacked. And in every election, I realize that may be true. So my counter argument is that maybe we are hacked just in the easy parts, the easy part that basically go to our fears, to our deep instincts, and maybe politics is included in that, but I hope I'm not hacked in other more, I guess, deep things I have, I hope. Maybe all this is an illusion, all this talk is an illusion, and we're just a game of an alien culture. But I recommend to read this if you haven't read. There's a TED talk that emotions are predictions, that emotions are basically just like machine learning. You learn from the past to react to something. But the interesting thing that Lisa Feldman Barrett says is that we can change that. And I have practiced that, and it's true. You can change your reactions, but you need to do it consciously. Every time you will get mad, you say, no, I can change it. And the good thing is that at some point you don't get mad any longer. And that's good, because the other person gets more mad. Loss of jobs. Well, yeah, but we can leverage AI. I mean, we need to train this AI. The only people that can train this AI is humans. So we need teachers for robots, teachers for AI. And these will be people, and it has to be smart people. Maybe we'll do more literature and art. Finally, we have time to do whatever we want, and I hope we have a universal salary so we can afford it. Yeah, I don't mind. I will never get bored if I can do whatever I want. Yeah? Loss of skills. So how many people here cannot find a place without the GPS today? I know many people. Yeah? You know, these skills are from like hundreds of thousands of years ago. We were experts in finding food and other things. We have it in our genetic code, but we are losing that. It's a problem. Well, it's a problem if you don't have a smartphone, or you don't have internet, or you don't have battery. It's a problem. And there are many interesting examples. Also, when the GPS makes a mistake, that also is a problem. But maybe it's not bad when the AI is better than humans. I already said that. Maybe it's OK. Although it would be a good day, someone also suggests this, one day per week, you shouldn't use your smartphone. Can you do that? Maybe not during a work day, but maybe Saturday or Sunday you can be without a smartphone, and maybe you rediscover life. So things that also are in the future, I don't have counter arguments, because this is complicated. So yeah, that's true. If you have all these AIs communicating, it becomes a different being, something that we cannot do. We communicate, but we don't agree. We don't have protocols that all work all the time. And if you read this famous story that was, at some point, the best science fiction story, The Last Question from Asimov, I guess that's what I'm talking about. So the authority switches to algorithms and owners of our data. And these are private companies. We need to worry? I'm not sure. Maybe yes. We have even more inequality, and we're seeing that. So all humanity has a better standard of life, but inequality is increasing a lot. And then, this is the hardest one, no sense of purpose. But basically, that's true today. That this is his claim. So basically, all animals have a sense of purpose. Maybe very simple, but they know what to do in life. Maybe humankind doesn't know what to do in life. Just keep going, trying to get more money, I don't know. And then if that happens, we'll be irrelevant. So the epilogue. No privacy. Health will be the first step for that. You are willing to have no privacy to have better health. Explainable and transparent algorithms. This may happen with software insurance. This is like a nightmare. This will be like health in the US. Programs will be so expensive because no one will be responsible for the line of code, the data used to train, whatever you involve a person in the process. Because it's not only about the code, it's about the training data, it's about everything. So if we let lawyers decide this, will be a nightmare. Ethics for robots, remote knowledge workers, augmented humanity is another issue. Some people may be able to pay for things that make you better. And it's a very fine line between plastic surgery and augmented humanity. I don't know where is the line, but it will be dangerous. Good thing up to now, no one is using CRISP, if you know what is CRISP, DNA editing, in humans. But who knows? I mean, soldiers. quoting Harari again. Either democracy will successfully reinvent itself in a radically new form, or humanity will live in a digital dictatorship. He's very pessimistic. He says, I met him once, he says that all the optimistics lives in Silicon Valley. I live there, but I try not to be so optimistic. But I'm optimistic. I think technological change is overall good, but we need to be careful. We don't need to think on ethics after. We always think on ethics after we have a person killed by a driving, self-driving car, like happened in Arizona. I don't know if you have seen how the current president of the Philippines used Facebook last year in the last election, or you have read about social score in China, right? Every person will have a social score. Well, here in the US, everyone has a FICO score. So I don't know why it's so different. So I always wonder why this is different. So in one case, it's kind of private, in one case, it's kind of public. But it's the same. We have scores elsewhere, everywhere, in Facebook too. So the question is, are we evolving towards Solaria? And I guess now you can guess I like science fiction. So this is from another book of Asimov, Naked Sun. Who read this? Okay. So this is a world where every person lives in isolation, 1,000 kilometers away from any other person. So they cannot see a person in person because it's like too close. In some countries, closeness is like here. In other countries, you have to be like here. In Solaria, it was like 1,000 kilometers. So the story is about something else. You can read it. It's a very interesting book. But maybe we will work like in the augmented humans that live in isolation, and maybe we need a lot of space to do that. So the only way to be optimistic, and with this I will finish, is this. If you saw Arrival, please come soon, because this is with the leaders we have today, this is becoming really dangerous. I'm not joking, right? I hope it will be a joke, but it's not a joke. Okay. I was in, by chance, sometimes I have very bad chance, I was in Guam the day that the North Korean leader threatened to send an atomic bomb. I was in Guam that day, and I talked to local people. They were really scared. I said, try to convince a person. I mean, that will not happen. I don't know. I mean, you don't live in Guam. Yeah, that's true. I don't live in Guam. But yeah, this is scary. So questions or explanations?